Hello, thank you very much for joining us. This is Platform, and today we'll look at one of the basics of mankind. Shelter, in whatever form it comes, requires the principles of sustainability, an integrated approach expected to be followed to ensure a durable and efficient planning. Now, the current ever-changing environment of the construction industry demands quantities of surveyors to update their knowledge and skills to cope with the changes globally in order for them to be able to manage a construction project productively and increase their ability in accordance with the current demands of construction, especially in a developing country like Nigeria, where the essence of infrastructural development depends largely on human development. So you ask, how much attention have been paid to quantity surveying in the country? This is where the Nigerian Institute of Quantity Surveyors comes in, an umbrella body for quantity surveyors in the country, founded in 1969. They are the go-to people when it comes to comprehensive costing and cost management services for construction projects, more like the person who calculates the cost of materials and labor on a construction project based on an architect's plan. And the watchword is, simply put, value for money. There is a whole lot we want to examine on quantity surveying in Nigeria, especially in the role of nation building. That's our focus on Platform, and my guest is the president of the Nigerian Institute of Quantity Surveyors, Malla Mohammed Abba Tor. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very
QS
much.
QS
that, Abba Tor. That's right.
That's how it's called.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, so let me take you through a bit of his profile. Malla Mohammed Tor is a registered quantity surveyor. He holds Masters of Science in Project Management from Aden University, United Kingdom, Master of Business Administration, MBA Marketing, and Postgraduate Diploma in Management, respectively, from Abubakar Tafawa Balewa University, Bauchi. He's a fellow Nigerian Institute of Quantity Surveyors, Fellow Institute of Construction Industry Arbitrators, Fellow National Institute of Marketing of Nigeria, and Member Association for Project Management. QS Abba Tor joined the services of African Petroleum PLC in 1994 as the pioneer quantity surveyor. While in the employment of African Petroleum PLC, he had the privilege and responsibility of setting up the quantity surveying unit. He voluntarily resigned from African Petroleum PLC in 2002 to pursue interest in consultancy services, which has been doing so well. QS Abba Tor has played a leading role in costing and cost management of several projects in both public and private sectors, including construction of ultra-modern sports complex, several offices for government ministries, departments and agencies, commercial buildings, etc., you name it. He's just an expert when we're talking quantity surveying. Once again, welcome to Platform.
Thank you very much. It's my pleasure being here.
Our pleasure to have you. And you. As usual, we have a panelist join us, and no other person than Adebola Brookslyn Sunday. He's our NTA correspondent. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
All right, so for me, QS Abba Tor, for me, this is going to be like a school.
Yeah.
You know, when we mention quantity surveying, it doesn't readily comes to mind, like, okay, like a click, I know what this is about, you know, or what it entails. So you're going to be schooling us for the benefit of those who don't understand what it entails when we're talking quantity surveying in the country. What does it entail? What is it all about?
Thank you very much for giving us the opportunity to be here. I want to begin by appreciating the management of NTA for giving us the platform to showcase our competencies across the country. Over time, we've enjoyed very close relationship with NTA, and this is one of such opportunities, and we just cannot appreciate you enough. Thank you so very much. Now, you've rightly gave in your background the essence or roles of quantity surveyors. Quantity surveyors actually are experts trained in project costing, right from inception or conceptualization down to implementation, commissioning, and even during maintenance. We come in to provide the resources as you mentioned, in terms of materials, labor, and plant that will now go into any given projects, be it at whatever stage, in all sectors of the economy and all kinds of projects. We are cost experts. That's what we do, and that's the bottom line of our training. So that's the... Now, if you look at the roles or functions of quantity surveyors, if I may just go there, functions of quantity surveyors include in the areas of project costing, as I mentioned. We are also into project management, post-contract auditing, contract administration. We are into issues like resolving construction disputes in the industry. We do quite a lot. Our members are out there in the field, resolving issues, resolving disputes between clients and contractors in so many areas, because cost, as you rightly mentioned, is one of the key elements of what we call project baseline, where you have the quality, you have cost, and also the completion period or delivery period. So we play a prominent role in that respect, and therefore disputants call upon us to come in, appreciate and resolve their dispute, and they're so happy each time they call us or each time they call upon NIQS, that's the body, Nigerian Institute of Quantity Surveyors, to appoint arbitrators to go and preside and resolve their issues and issue their awards.
Okay, we're going to dwell into that much later in the course of the discourse, but I'm curious now. Yeah. 50 years ago, you know, quantity surveyors in the country used to be 20, including British nationalities. Yeah. Now, the indigenes, talking about Nigerians, we're now up to 10 to 15. In as much as the name signifies quantity, is it about quantity or quality when we're looking at professionals in the country? Because the narrative has changed. We have a lot of quantity surveyors in the country.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much. Yeah. Within the industry, you have the designers, by that I mean the architects, engineers, who look into the aspect of quality. They design, specify, and give standards. Then the quantity surveyors, based on the documents or designed parameters prepared by the design specialists or experts, we now translate those into what we call the bills of quantities or later document called material schedules. So we now look into quantity, but translating into the specifications and quality parameters set out by the design consultants or design experts. Mm. In other words, you have a collaborative approach in the industry where you have seven professional bodies. So we come in to work hand in hand. There are those responsible for designs.
Okay.
Right, we don't claim to be one of such, and then we are now into the costing of the, that is the project costing, and in it we bring out the quantities in terms of what is required, materials, you know, labor and plant, and also price them out. So these are the distinction between the designers, who are really looking into the quality aspects, and then the quantity surveyors, who now look at the quantity, but then generating from the documents prepared by the design expert, translating their quality parameters into our own documents.
It's a value chain. Mm. Adebola, I know you
want to come. I just want to ask you a follow-up question.
Yeah.
Who is a quantity surveyor, or what do I need to have or qualification to be called or to practice as a quantity surveyor?
Yeah, within the institute, we have routes of qualifications. Now, there are different routes. But in all of these cases, you have to be, generally speaking, you have to be graduates of quantity surveying from universities or polytechnics within the country or outside that are accredited by our own regulatory body, that is Quantity Surveyors Registration Board of Nigeria. So once if you complete that, and after your mandatory service year, you now fill or complete application desiring to be part of us through what we call the probationership. Then from there, we now compel you to fill theory and logbooks over a period under the tutelage of senior quantity surveyors. Then thereafter, we allow you to take examinations first, maybe a year after the service year, or 2 years as the case may be. Then you now go through those processes before we now certify you as qualified. That is one stage. The second stage is when we finish, we now put you forward to the regulatory body, that's Quantity Surveyors Registration Board. They will also look at the process you went through from NIQS, then thereafter bring you on board, and then put you, you know, in their own register. These are the processes one needs to follow to be a fully qualified, certified, and registered quantity surveyor. Now, all those that are parading themselves as quantity surveyors, exactly, but without first going through this process that I mentioned, are not our members. So the members of the public should appreciate and understand that we hold our members very, very close based on what we call code of ethics and professional conduct. Okay. Now, if you are a member, each quantity surveyor you are bringing on board to serve on your project is being subjected to this document. I will make it available to you. So you have the covenant of the Institute behind you once you engage our members. And the list of our members are available on our website and in so many places.
Okay, so now, from what you're saying, it's a rigorous process before you can be certified.
Very rigorous.
Quantity surveyor.
Yes.
Now, the whole essence is to give the client value for money, so to say.
Yeah.
Now, considering the critical role a quantity surveyor plays in any construction project, would you say this is one aspect of consultancy people have embraced in the country? I know for big projects that is in line, that is part of the planning, but what about maybe a young man or a young woman, women too, go into building today, do they readily opt for a quantity surveyor if they want to see the value of whatever project they want to execute?
Thank you very much. I'm so happy for that follow-up question. The fact is that the level of visibility leaves much to be desired. That is why we are engaging with respectable organization like NTA to partner with us so as to make our roles of project management, our roles of project costing to the public for them to appreciate and understand the value quantity surveyors can add onto their project. For instance, quantity surveying or the Nigerian Quantity Surveyors, NIQS, has been in existence, as you said, for about 50 years. We celebrated our 50 years last year. But the level of penetration at the formal sector is relatively appreciable. But in the informal sector, not that much appreciable. So we had to really to recreate and innovate on how to make ourselves known to the lower cadre of construction
middle
activities.
Class, if you like.
Middle class or the lower class, okay, for them to appreciate quantity surveying by offering a product or services that meets their expectations. Customer satisfaction is key. If you don't give them values that they can appreciate, they wouldn't understand what quantity surveying is up to. And you may not add on to what they are doing. So now, during the 50 years period I mentioned, our leaders, the founding fathers, did quite a lot of work in order to bring quantity surveying at the front banner, the construction industry. This is our 50 years quantity surveying in Nigeria, NIQS at 50. But now, recently, we set back and as an ongoing concern, what do we do to penetrate the informal sector? They also have to enjoy the value-adding capability of quantity surveyors for us to really ensure optimal utilization of resources that are scarce so that they can now do much more with so much, with so little. And that's why we launched a product offering called Resource Scheduling. Resource Scheduling is a reader-friendly document.
Okay.
Unlike the beautiful quantity that is quite sophisticated and elitist, Resource Scheduling is a document in which the offering of the quantity surveys has been cascaded down to, if you want to call it, materials such as cement, number of bags of cement you need, number of blocks you require on your field, how many rods of reinforcement, it is to that level. So that we are now convinced, and based on the feedback we are receiving from the field, the public is embracing us, and with level of sustainability, if we are now sustainable in pushing through this, then sooner than later, even the micro level of project elements like a little farmhouse, a small BQ somewhere, even if you want to construct a kitchen, you need schedules. And we are now saying we can do that better. We can produce, and they will not stress you by going through what we call the bills of quantity, which is quite complex. People, it's not reader friendly. Bills of quantity needs further analysis for you to appreciate the content. But social doodling is so clear, it's so reader friendly. You can now read on a sheet of paper how many bucks you need for your project, how many rods of reinforcement you want. So that's where we are. Now, with this approach, with this method that we adopted recently, we should be able to appreciate even the lowest of the activities in the industry. And then going forward, they should be able to understand and appreciate what quantity surveyors are up to.
But you know, QS, one question readily comes to mind. It doesn't come cheap. As cost and project management, you know, professionals, if I have to hire a quantity surveyor to, you know, do all the checkmating for my project before I'm back on it, it doesn't come cheap.
The issue is that that's one of the areas we want to really disabuse the minds of the public.
Okay.
In the long run, it is even the cheapest for you to do. What do we give? As professionals, we give you complete rest of mind, peace of mind. Once if we come in, we now take the burden of a lot of uncertainty and risk elements off from your head. You can now focus on some of your own activities while we now take those issues completely, and then we give you quality service. So in the final analysis, it is cheaper for you to bring in a professional to anchor your project, rather than assuming that they might be expensive only for you to resort to some other, what we normally call, or persons we normally call as quacks. Mm. By that I mean people who are not within our own institute or the Quantitative Registration Board. If you now bring them on to really anchor your costing and cost activities for you, in the long run, you are now going to lose quite a lot, because he's not trained, he's not equipped. Even as we are, as trained as we are, we do what we call continuous professional development. Because the changes in the global environment, the technology itself are changing.
Yes.
So you cannot use the formula you have been using decades ago to come and make a proposition to a client. You know, clients nowadays are becoming more sophisticated. They are becoming more complicated. And their tests and requirements are also changing.
Yes. Okay.
So if you are now stagnant, you might not be able to meet up their expectations. So we do carry out a lot of professional development, continuous professional development, in order for us to be at par with the expectations of the employers. Then what of somebody who is not even within our fault at all? He has not been trained ab initio, and then he has not been updating his skill and knowledge over time. Definitely, if you approach such a person, he is not going to give you what he hasn't has. He cannot give
what he doesn't have.
That's the point. So come to us. In the long run, it's cheaper. And it is just the mindset of persons believing that, okay, if you bring them in, it will be expensive. But we are now going to reduce quite a lot of unnecessary wastages. Once if we give you our documentation and our full attention, a lot of risk elements will be removed. A lot of uncertainty will be downplayed. Mm. And then we can now come up with things that you can trust, submission that you can now trust.
Okay.
Our integrity and dignity are on the line.
Exactly.
Each of our members that are really coming forward to render services are subjected to court and court of conduct and professional ethics I mentioned earlier. So they wouldn't do something that is not within the expectations of the institute. So to that extent, the advocacy is that people should not be scared of approaching us. Approach us, and then we now give you the assurance that in the final analysis, it is cheaper, and we'll appreciate you.
All right, I want to ask now that you are turning your attention or your focus to low class or middle class in the construction industry. What are you doing talking about monitoring and evaluation to look at or to ensure that these materials are not just poor, but the quality match the price?
Thank you very much. In any given project life cycle, if you permit me to call that, you have what we call project initiation, project planning, implementation or execution, monitoring and evaluation, and also close-up. Now, at the planning stage, in collaboration with the design consultant or design experts, we translate what they put onto the papers onto our own documents, the bills of quantities, which was later will be analyzed onto the research schedules. What we do is, at the planning level, we now exactly conform with the parameters put down by the designers. And if we now get, that's at the planning stage. And remember, the planning documents or the project baselines form the benchmark on which to track the execution or implementation stage. So once if we move into the implementation or execution stage, we have a platform, a framework, a template. Now that serves as a basis for us to now monitor the execution of the project. So once if the plan has been done competently, again, by the experts or the professionals I mentioned earlier, if you go into the execution stage, we also ensure that what was put down is now translated, you know, on the ground on what we call the actual implementation or execution. Now, we do monitor to ensure that there are no deviations, no unapproved deviations from the plan that we earlier set on. So the quality of materials has been stated clearly in terms of specification, in terms of standard, be it local or international standards, by design consultants. We now translated that into our own documents. So during the monitoring, during the execution, we now monitor to ensure that there is a correlation between what is being implemented with the plans. If there are changes, because changes will occur.
Exactly.
The plans that you have are not sacrosanct. So there are a lot of reasons for changes to occur during implementation stage. In effect, they do happen. Then we have to really relate it to what we earlier, you know, set out, then try to define what are the reasons for those changes coming on. So again, it's an assurance that the employer or the developer or the client, be it public or in the private sector, will now see that the monitoring will ensure he gets value for money. That is the key word, value for money on what we earlier set out. That gives him the proper opportunity of planning his structures of finances and all of those things. Then by the time we go there, we also ensure that what has been stated here should be brought in here. So the danger is that even if you bring in the professionals to do the good work for you at the planning stage, if you now go and do a different thing entirely at the execution or at the implementation stage without involving us, there could be some approaches that are not proper, which if we are not involved, then definitely. So we are now preaching or advocating that once if we prepare these documents for you, now bring us on board also the engineers. On us mean I'm talking about the whole industry. Mm-hmm. Us means the engineers, the architects, the quantity surveyors. Yes, once if we are there, right? So we'll now ensure that what has been stated is implemented in this way. Okay, so if you do that, that will now go a long way in also trying to address what is commonly now as building collapse. Building collapse happens because you now bring in somebody who can now do something at variance with what has been stated.
Hmm.
But professionals worth their salt will not and will insist that what has been designed should be
executed.
You know, it's good you mentioned the building collapse.
Yeah.
Let's look at planning and urban development, which is part of the services
that's
of
right.
quantities of
that's right. That's right.
Now, on a broader scope,
yeah.
we get to see a lot of illegal structures. We've seen building collapse, which is one of the major challenges in the country.
Yeah.
Would you say we have regulated as a nation planning and urban development, you know, in the country?
Yeah. Okay. The issue about planning and urban development is actually, you know, not within the ambit of quantity surveying, but I can now say a little bit about them. We're in the industry. We are in the industry. You know, we have what we call town and regional planners.
Okay.
That they are core competency areas.
Okay.
They do that. But generally speaking, I'm now talking generally as a person, a participant, a stakeholder, you know, within the construction industry.
Yes.
Yeah, the level of planning, level of compliance, if you look at it, the citizens should also cooperate, you know, with the government agencies and government at all levels.
Hmm.
The issue is a serene and well-planned environment is conducive and sustainable today and going forward. So the professionals, again, should be allowed to do their jobs. The urban development agencies that you mentioned, which actually are largely populated by town and regional planners, should be given the leeway to practice what they studied. We should cooperate with them. And what they're asking is not much. They are now saying, a plant layout is what is fit for purpose, what is fit for human habitation. That will now ensure sustainability of human habitation. So they are now saying, once if you want to embark upon any development, let us take a look at your own proposals, right? Now we evaluate it, we critique where necessary, and at the tail end we now process and give you the approval. Once the approval is given to you, it is in conformity with the layout they have already planned in terms of what we call the master plan. So let us not see the government activities in such areas as negative. Rather, we should cooperate with them because it is for the good of all of us. A planned environment is the most sustainable environment. So that is, but then that area is purely for town and regional planners, not quantity surveying, but I'm talking generally as a stakeholder in the construction industry.
Okay, you made mention of building collapse when you were explaining the other time.
Yeah.
If we have institute, National Institute of Quality Surveyors, why do we still have building collapse in the country?
Yeah. I touched this a little bit earlier. The issue is that we kept on drawing the attention of the developers to the fact that engage professionals, right? If you engage professionals at the design stage, they will now do the right thing because they are well trained to make sure that their calculations now stand the test of time. There is also that issue of substandard materials. Okay. But the issue is, it also boils down to the fact that a professional that is qualified and registered will not specify material that are substandard.
Okay.
He wouldn't. Okay, so at the planning stage, you are rest assured that he will now specify what is right, that which meets the expectations, and that which conforms with local and international standards, right, at the planning stage. If you now move into the implementation stage, or execution stage, or the construction stage, you wouldn't hear or see a professional putting down this at the planning stage, and then coming again to do something at variance with this, which might lead to collapse of those structures. So critical in the whole of this is the engagement, what we call team formation at the planning stage. Mm-hmm. Engagement of core professionals. If you engage them, they will now take the burden off your head.
Okay.
And they wouldn't want, for whatever reason, to put their licenses or what we call their certificates on the line, mm-hmm. For it to be led into this at the tail end. They are now compelled to appear before pro panels, and eventually, if they are found culpable, their certificates or licenses are being withdrawn.
Wow.
No professional will now go into those kind of things. Okay, so the fundamentals is that engage persons who know whatever he's doing, persons who have fully registered, and persons who, in terms of any infractions, there are steps you as a developer can take, because it means he must have misled you, right? And then you incurred a lot of expenses, or entered into some avoidable cost. You can now come to us through our regulatory bodies. In our own case, we have the Quantity Surveyor Registration Board of Nigeria.
Wow.
So within the act, there are stipulations on how to deal with persons who misconduct themselves in that fashion. But then if you now bring in a person who is not within our fault, it is difficult for us to deal with it, because we don't prosecute. We don't go to the place and now arresting persons who are not our members for them to be subjected to
our
own.
Do you do that for your members?
So our members, once if we now receive the, right now we are treating so many cases, and depending on the level of infractions, we met out sanctions to our members. And the fact that we have these documents I mentioned earlier to you, they don't involve themselves into such unholy acts. And
okay,
that is the assurance
we
are giving.
But you serve as mediators and arbitrators.
Of course.
Okay.
Yeah.
When there's a dispute.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So how does that work?
Yeah. The issue is, we quantity surveyors are also expert trained in construction dispute resolution.
Okay.
So the out there you have a lot of construction activities going on, either by the government, which is the biggest purchaser of construction products, or even the public, the private sector participants. So if they have disputes or disagreements, it is always better, cost effective, cheaper, and then friendly to come to us. So as NIQS, as an organization, they do write to us that we have disagreements in areas, these are the areas that we have disputes or issues. So we now appoint from the list of our arbitrators, qualified arbitrators, appoint to mediate, arbitrate, and in all cases, depending on what they are now asking from us. And right now we have our members, you know, all over the place carrying out such responsibilities, which is very, very friendly. And at the tail end, the parties can now have that win-win position, and they can now go on with their businesses without going into the legal processes that might take years and years, you know, and the project will now be stalled. So they come to us. So we discharge that very, very well. And again, in order to complement that effort, we have within us, we have Quantity Surveyors Academy. So the QS Academy, you know, as shortly referred to, are well capacitated in training arbitrators, you know, within quantity surveying. And in some instances, professionals who are not even quantity surveyors do attend the QS Academy. Yeah. And then we now train them and issue certificates at the end of it. And you see them doing marvelously well. They are doing very, very well.
Okay,
and that's part of our own contribution to national development.
Okay, QS, let's nip the problem in the board.
Yeah, yeah.
We've talked about building collapse.
Yeah.
And we see a lot of illegal structures that later on it gets demolished and all of that.
Yeah.
What are some of the challenges associated with accurately quantifying construction work and organizing a quantified information for the control process?
Yeah.
It's a whole process.
Yeah.
So what are the challenges associated with it?
Yeah. The what you call challenges are what I would now refer to as the requirements or expectations of the project. Once if the projects are well detailed, right? As we are not designers, once the projects are well designed by the design consultants or design experts, that's architects or engineers, right?
Yes.
So once if those details or those information are fully made available, quantity surveyors don't have any challenge in preparing accurate bills of quantities. And that will also lead to presentation of resource scheduling. So, but where you have the information is haphazard, right? You have a lot of assumptions. You have a lot of uncertainties. You have a lot of issues that are not yet resolved. And still the clients are in a hurry to move, you know, to the site. Yeah, agreed, we have techniques. We have tools of handling such issues through what we call approximate or preliminary estimating. But then the accuracy will now not be as fully developed concept. So we'll now advise greatly that for you to have a clear picture, and within the time constraint or other constraint you might have as a developer, it is always good for you to insist on your design experts to give you, you know, that full information. Because the quantity surveyor's job is dependent upon the information.
Exactly.
So they now flow together. And that's why collaboration
is key.
Exactly. Right? Now it is in this that we are now also advocating, you know, building information modeling is also now is an in thing that will now give a platform for all the professionals to interface. It makes things easier. Now we are at the forefront of also popularizing that approach or that environment, build information modeling. That will now compel that all of us are on the same page. If you're on the same page, then you are guaranteed of the accuracy of the cost information you are receiving. And we can now plan and structure your finances based on that. But where you have the information as sketchy, then the accuracy you are now mentioning will not be as accurate as where you have the information is full or complete.
I know that one aspect any developer will consider is the cost of materials.
Yeah.
You want to have a structure put up, you have to put all that into consideration, if the quantity surveyor you know, is creating all the mark, bringing all the lines out on how much this will cost, the planning. Cost of materials, how does it affect, you know, the effective delivery of projects?
Yeah, that's correct. You know, particularly of recent, due to the rising cost of materials, quantity surveying documents are issued at time X, at today's date. That is one. And secondly, we cannot run away from the fact that there is, if you like, an unabated increase or rises in prices of materials, which could be attributed to so many factors.
Yes.
In the industry, you might I appreciate the fact that we have a lot of important components, and those imported component, imported material are subject to vagaries of the macroeconomic parameters. We cannot run away from that. That now makes it difficult to predict, because the macroeconomic stability is key. Now, again, the demand and supply issues, or economy factors, where you have the supply falling short of the demand, that also will now mean that the prices of materials on which you quantify basis computation at time X will now change. But we have approaches of dealing with that through some, if what we have fluctuation clauses, the materials or the rates appended by the contractors at the tender dates, right? That now serves as the baseline. Now, going forward, if you have such changes as I mentioned, then they will now be subjected to that. Again, the cost of materials are also rising due to the fact that the infrastructure issue you mentioned earlier on, power is an important infrastructure element. When manufacturers have to really power their standby generators, perhaps on continuous 20 hours, again, in terms of distribution, where the product is, you have to take it to the end users through road transportation. These are cost elements that now build up and contribute to continuous rising cost of materials. But then we now also train our members to be on the watch out, and they have to gauge. Such issues are outside the control of the quantity surveyor because they are economy issues, they are macroeconomic issues. But then we have to really work towards that. The government, the federal government, must be commended. Of recent, there has been a lot of attention being paid to rail transportation. That will now crush the transportation component, because the freight movement, for instance, you have the manufacturer of a given critical product, perhaps in Lagos area, and that has to be transported by road to the other side of the country, perhaps to Maiduguri or to Sokoto. That transportation cost is huge factor within his cost parameters. But whereas if the rail transportation is fully developed, you know, it is more sustainable, right? And then that will now is cheaper. That will also ensure that our roads will now have longer lifespan, because the pressure on the roads will greatly reduce. So it is in the right direction. So these are some of the things that could be done in the long run to crush the prices of those critical materials. Some materials are quite critical. Again, quantity surveyors are advocating that we also should have change of attitudes. Where, for instance, you have, you know, some material within the country locally produced that are as good as those you are now aiming to import from outside.
Yes, yes.
But still there is this penchant for insisting on the imported ones. In terms of value, this material you have locally could be, is cheaper, more affordable, and can give you better service than what you are now importing from outside. So why can't we sit down and reason that it is in using our own locally produced materials that we can now contribute to the development of the country?
Yes.
Each component or each item or material you purchase from outside, you are creating jobs. Yes. And then your own people are not, you know, being out of, you know, out of jobs. So we have to have a change of attitude, a change of mind. Those, you know, at the micro level, if each and every one of us have that change in attitude of embracing something, item A that we have within the country can compete favorably with item X that you have, you are bringing from outside, which will now be subjected to the parameters I mentioned earlier, economy, macroeconomy indices and issues. You have this. Now, if you continue patronizing or purchasing this, you are creating jobs for people within the country.
Okay.
So that is not too difficult for, but it's attitude. We have to change our attitudes.
Okay, talking about attitude now, you talked about importation of materials.
Yeah.
We still have a situation where you can say importation of expertise or experts in the building and other projects, industry.
Yeah.
Recently, or not too long ago, President Buhari signed into law executive order talking about local content.
Yeah.
Why do we still have engineers or builders being imported? Is it that we cannot compete favorably?
Yeah, the first and foremost, that effort is quite commendable. You know, it's giving the latitude or the opportunity for us to really bring forth our skill and expertise to anchor our projects, and for government to give that backing is quite commendable. Now, it's still, I want to call it work in progress.
Okay.
The starting point is we have the executive order now on ground.
Yes.
And within the industry, we are collaborating. The engineers, the architects, the quantity surveyors, and all the other town planners, you know, estate surveyors and valuers, all of us are resolute in giving support to that executive order to ensure that whatever that is needed for us to do, we are doing it, and so far we are not being found wanting. So it's work in progress, and I think as time goes on, we'll now occupy the prior place in the industry. We can continue doing our best,
okay.
And the spirit is good. The spirit is good, and we are also encouraged, and we are motivated to continue putting in our best in the development of the country. It's helpful, and it's the right way to go, and
okay.
We're happy. Want to appreciate Mr. President for that gesture.
You know what I find interesting that beats my imagination is the fact that it's all about giving people value for money, managing cost and all of that.
Yeah.
And when we're talking management of money,
forgive
me if I'm wrong, women are better managers, you know, but I don't find a lot of quantity surveyors, women quantity surveyors, in the male-dominated profession this.
Yeah.
What would you do to change that narrative?
Yeah. Thank you very much. In NIQS, or quantity surveying community, it is good I mentioned that we had our first female president.
Oh,
wow.
Yes, okay. Yes, in quantity surveying about couple of years ago, and to our delight, she performed wonderfully well, right? And that is one. And secondly, years back, we had an association called Association of Women Quantity Surveyors, WAQSN, Women Association of Quantity Surveyors in Nigeria. Now, that body is one of the most vibrant body within the NIQS. So you might be surprised that we have very resourceful ladies in our midst, and they are doing very, very well in their calls in public service, in private sectors of the economy. They are doing very, very well. And it is not known that it cannot be generalized that they are not doing, in fact, they are doing it as good as men, or if you want to call it your own parents, you know, better than even the men. So they are doing quite well. And in terms of numbers, they are quite impactful. They are doing a lot. If you see them, the current secretary of marketing is a lady, and she's doing very, very well in that assignment. And so this is to tell you that women are, you know, coming forward to take leadership positions in the institute, and they are doing very, very well.
Is there
the issue is we are very, very gender friendly,
okay.
And we are mainstreaming you know, our ladies, you know, as supposed to be, and they are really doing their very best. If you see them around, they call themselves QS ABC. They're doing fantastically well.
Impressive.
Yeah. So, and I also give it to you that women are better managers. You said so. All right. So,
but let's look at catching them young.
Yeah.
Quantity surveying is not a readily profession.
Yeah.
You know, young people just want to pick up.
Yeah.
So, what is the institute doing? Mm-hmm. You know, to help. You know, help change the perception of young people, especially going to secondary schools where decisions of careers are being, you know, choices of careers are being made.
Correct. Now, part of the reason is that quantity surveying, you know, relative to architects or engineers, you know, it's a younger profession, right? And so we need a lot of promotion, a lot of sensitization, a lot of advocacy. So at the chapters level, we have 34 chapters, you know, within the country.
Wow.
Now, they do visit, as part of their own responsibilities, they do visit, you know, secondary schools and even primary schools. And in order to use your word to catch them young, you know, telling them the functions and how rewarding quantity surveying profession could be. And that we are confident that the narrative will now change going forward, and we do that sustainably. In fact, we now charge the chapters to continue visiting schools and appear in television programs to also to enlighten the public. And if you are talking to the students in the secondary school, even primary school, we do go to primary schools. Now that also you are now engaging the parents, so the parents should as well look at the the possibility of having a rewarding professional career in quantity surveying. So we kept on doing that in order to ensure that we have them to consider quantity surveying as profession, as now they move into the higher institutions. So we do that continuously. And so as we are now visiting or paying advocacy visits to government agencies and critical stakeholders in the industry for them to engage quantity surveyors in order to drive the value adding capability. And then at the other end also, we are now encouraging young ones to join the profession. Right. Now it is in that wise that advocacy is very, very important. During the last workshop held last month, I was in Maiduguri, that's my home state, and His Excellency, our governor, during the reception, during the program actually, at the opening, he now announced sponsorship for 100 indigenous of Borno State to take into quantity surveying. Wow. So now this is to tell you that the quantity survey that we have on ground should be engaged more optimally by the participants in the industry. And then we have to, because we are now 5,000 quantity surveyors for the whole of this country is nowhere being enough at all. Okay. And now that we are opening up and tap opportunities from the informal sector, right? People who ordinarily wouldn't be looking for quantity surveyors because there is complex in appreciating and understanding what the roles are. Now we are now coming in with product offering or service offering that cannot penetrate the informal sector. It means that sooner than later, you wouldn't see the quantity surveyors to match up with that. So we are not really relenting in trying to encourage the entry into the profession so that there wouldn't be gap.
Okay.
So it's a double prong approach. So I want to really commend His Excellency for that initiative. We are very happy, and we want to call on upon others also to appreciate what we can offer, and then allow the young ones to take into the professional quantity surveying.
All right,
because cost is issue.
Okay, I know Adebola is itching to ask a question because we're actually coming to the end of this discussion. So yeah. Adebola, your final question.
Yeah, I just want to ask you this simple question.
Yeah,
50 years down the lane, where do you want to see NIQS in another 50 years?
50 years in NIQS, want to see the public, right, appreciating and embracing quantity surveys in order for them to add value to whatever they are doing. 50 years down the line, want to have quantity survey profession resonating in the minds of every Nigerian, because we are reforming and we are also rebranding to give our best to the populace. That's why we have rebranding. This is our rebranding document. We now launch a rebranding project roadmap. This is to tell the populace that we can now give a better service as time goes on. We are innovative. We are not stagnant. So whatever the expectations of the customer, we are now coming with product and service that will now match or even exceed the expectations of the customers. So want the populace to take full advantage of the competency and professionalism of quantity surveyors. So let it resonate in their minds, because it will now help in their projects, it will help in controlling their cost. And if we are controlling cost of developers, then we are now contributing to national development. So we need the larger platform, to use the title of your program, a larger platform so that we can now contribute optimally to national development, because this is the only nation that we have, and we cannot shy away from you know putting in our best. And again, before if you allow me just a second or two,
I'm not round enough
okay.
yet. I just want to chip into what you're saying, QS.
Okay.
Very briefly, I know the vision is to ensure that the quantity surveyors is responsible for total cost and procurement management, be the best, you know, and compete favorably with the global trend. We look at today's administration, we look at the interest for infrastructural development, we look at sustainability plan, which is key. What would be your recommendations very briefly as we round this off?
The sustainability of infrastructure, you know, one in terms of adding to the existing stock, and also ensuring maintainability and maintenance of what you have on ground, are key drivers of any economy. So sustainable infrastructure is at the forefront of having a very, very promising economy. So we will now put in our best to ensure that the resources are applied optimally so that we now have to continue gaining and improving upon the infrastructure stock on ground. So there is no room for wastages at all in terms of funds because the funds are scarce. They are, you know, so if it is scarce, you have to really apply them effectively and optimally. Now it is in this guise that we are partnering with or collaborating with ICPC for some couple of years now.
Okay.
And it is gratifying that we received a letter of commendation or letter of appreciation for ICPC. Commending quantity surveys for, I like the word they use, for being patriotic. We have displayed high level of patriotism, right? We have displayed high level of doggedness and then value for money competency in what we do and the values we add to the works of ICPC in tracking constituency and executive projects across the country. So I wouldn't say, I want to appreciate my members out there, you know, great guys, great members doing beautiful jobs, you know, for ICPC. And through that, we are now contributing to national development. We are ensuring value for money in all that are being monitored by that, you know, organization, that's the ICPC. We are collaborating, and then we are now contributing. I appreciate them. I believe most of them are hearing me.
I'm afraid we're out of time. Okay. I know you want to go on. This is something you're very passionate about.
Yes.
Keep up the good work.
Yeah, thank you very much.
The whole essence is to ensure national development, sustainability
of
our growth. Thank you very much for your time.
We appreciate for being here, and we appreciate NTA for giving us delight all the times, and thank you so very much. Again, this has now been a very, very beautiful opportunity for us to reach out to the public. They will now.
We just have to go.
All right, thank you very much.
thank you very much, Brooks Lynn, developer Brooks Lynn Sunday. He's our panelist. Thank you for your time with us.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah.
Okay, our guest has been QS Mala Mohammed Abba Tor. He's the president, Nigerian Institute of Quantity Surveyors. And we've been looking at quantity surveyor in Nigeria, that is the role of nation building. It's a whole lot, it's a chain, and the whole essence is to give the client value for money while it also contributes to the value of growth, sustainable growth and development in the country. That's Platform. Thank you for your time with us. I'm Ruth Aguele.